Hello, everyone. Welcome to the First Principles video series. My name is Pradeep Vincent. I'm a SVP and Chief Technical Architect with OCI. Today, we're going to talk about something called virtual nodes. So Kubernetes has essentially become the de facto standard for container orchestration. And it's really helped, you know, the DevOps ecosystem grow. OCI has had, you know, OKE service for quite some time that essentially helps manage Kubernetes clusters. But at the end of the day, you know, customers still have to, you know, manage the physical nodes or the bare metal machines or the virtual machines. But, you know, what if we actually take away all of that? That's essentially the crux of, you know, today's conversation. A few months back, we launched a service called Container Instances, which is essentially a native OCI instance that essentially is pretty much a container. It's actually a few containers, you know, as part of a container pod that is fully managed by OCI. Today, we're going to talk about how we actually bridge between OKE, which is Oracle Kubernetes Engine, or Oracle Container Engine for Kubernetes, with the underlying construct called container instances so that customers who use Kubernetes on OCI don't have to worry about management of anything, including their underlying instance fleet, if you will. To explain how we do this, today we have with us Josh Horwitz, architect for OCI Container Service. Welcome, Josh.
Hey, Pradeep. Thanks for having me today. I'm super excited to talk about our new serverless product that we're offering with Kubernetes. So a little bit about me. As you mentioned, I'm Josh Horwitz. I'm a software architect in our containers and Kubernetes space, which includes our Kubernetes, container instances, serverless, and functions products that we offer at OCI. And I've been at Oracle for a little over 8 years and with OCI for the last four. And I've been using Kubernetes for the last 6 years, since version 1.4, a long time ago. Originally as a consumer running applications on it, and then 4 years ago shifted to helping build OCI's managed Kubernetes product.
Wow, okay, cool. So it looks like you've been with OCI for a while. Great to have you on today's video blog. So let's actually start with the basics. What is Kubernetes?
Yeah, so as you mentioned, Kubernetes has become the de facto standard for container orchestration. It's kind of the winning one that survived the last few years. And Kubernetes helps customers with deployment, scaling, and management of containers at scale. And customers are attracted to containers because it helps with portability, multi-cloud and hybrid scenarios. It helps improve DevOps and overall efficiency and a bunch of other reasons. But ultimately, it's one thing if you're managing containers on a couple hosts for a small application if you're running a blog. It's a whole other ballgame if you're running hundreds or tens of microservices across tens of hundreds of hosts and need orchestration to help you run that safely in production. And that's where Kubernetes comes into the picture. And Kubernetes is used for all sorts of use cases, from AI, ML, and big data, to running CI/CD systems, hosting web RESTful services, and a lot more, like running OCI services, for example. Kubernetes is comprised of many resources. However, the two main useful ones for this talk, or this discussion, are nodes and pods. And a pod is a collection of containers with shared resource and storage. And containers within a pod are always co-located and co-scheduled on the same node. And this is important because pods then share Linux namespaces like network and IPC. They have the same IP address. So all the containers inside the same pod have the same IP. They can share volumes between themselves. And they're a bad analogy maybe is like they're like a VM running multiple applications, but they're much more lightweight. And for a node, it represents a compute host in the normal sense. And so that could be a virtual machine or a bare metal host, and they run a collection of these pods or containers. And a node's comprised of various system components. And the two most important ones for this talk are the kubelet, which is the brains of the host, and the container runtime, which is commonly Docker or containerd or cryo nowadays. And nodes can have unique requirements for your workloads require, like GPUs, local NVMe drives, RDMA use cases, ARM or x86, and a lot of other scheduling requirements that you want to target your workloads on for your specific use cases.
Got it. Cool. So we recently launched this thing called container instances. Well, can you explain what's the relationship between Kubernetes and container instances?
Yeah, so as you mentioned earlier, container instances, a recently launched OCI service that provides serverless container experience. A container instance is very similar to a Kubernetes pod, actually by design. A container instance is a collection of one or more containers. They all share the same properties, such as Linux and network and IPC namespaces. You're able to share volumes between the different containers. They're all co-scheduled and co-located on the same hypervisor host inside the same virtual machine. And so as you can see, a container instance is basically a pod in Kubernetes. And that's why we're here today, is to talk about how we're bringing a Kubernetes experience to orchestrate container instances. And that's one of the big differences, is pods, whether it's Kubernetes or a container instance, are very simple primitives. By themselves, they don't have any higher orchestration components that helps them self-heal, schedule multiple containers or multiple pods that are running across different topology zones. And that's where Kubernetes comes into the picture to help container instances become a higher order service that can do a lot more complex things.
Got it. Cool. So, well, today we, you know, launched a new product or feature called Virtual Nodes. So it's essentially the crux, as you explained, is essentially to build a bridge between OKE, Oracle Container Engine for Kubernetes, to the underlying container instances, which we already launched a few months back, so that customers don't have to, you know, manage them separately, and they can essentially rely on Container Engine or the container instances rather, to do all the management for them. And then with Virtual Nodes, you know, we're going to take over more of the management so that customers that use Kubernetes don't have to worry about anything. Can you explain a little bit more about how that works?
Yeah, so a virtual node is a new type of node, and it looks and acts just like a normal node in Kubernetes. So if you run your favorite tools like kubectl, git node, you will see a virtual node alongside traditional nodes the same, and they look the same. One key difference is that virtual nodes are fully serverless and they're fully managed by OCI. So you no longer have to worry about patching their infrastructure. And unlike a traditional node, which runs pods via like a local container runtime, like Docker or Cryo, like we talked about earlier, virtual nodes rely on container instances for the container runtime. So virtual nodes act as a bridge between Kubernetes and OCI container instances to schedule and run workloads for customers. And customers can benefit from virtual nodes in a variety of ways. In general, we expect virtual nodes will largely replace managed nodes over time for the majority of use cases that don't require certain specialized hardware like bare metal machines. Customers get the benefit of fully managed experience that virtual nodes and container instances offer to reduce their operational burden with patching, since we take on the burden of patching the underlying infrastructure for you in safe ways. And customers also get to have simplification of their scaling patterns, because virtual nodes now support over 10x the number of pods that a normal node does. It means you have to worry about less as your applications scale. And most importantly, perhaps, customers get a cleaner and easier price model. Customers pay for what their applications need. They don't have to worry as much about overhead of traditional instances and trying to right size, even with flex shapes that OCI offers. You're able to pay for what you need and when you need it.
Got it. So essentially what I heard was, well, container instances, first of all, brings a whole bunch slew of advantages, you know, including the ultimate elasticity for with respect to compute capacity. You know, you can spin it up when you need and turn it off when you don't need. But at the same time, it offers many of the advantages of virtual machines, including, you know, strong isolation, you know, and ability to attach or natively leverage many of the OCI functionality. So now that we talked about the benefits customers are going to get via using container instances in the context of OKE using virtual node, let's talk a little bit about how we actually built virtual node internally.
Yeah, so virtual nodes, like I mentioned earlier, are a fully managed, highly available application that looks and acts like a real node to Kubernetes. And virtual nodes accomplish this by relying on the open source CNCF virtual kubelet project, which provides a translation layer between OCI and Kubernetes. And OCI is the first major cloud provider to offer a fully managed virtual kubelet product to provide a serverless Kubernetes experience via virtual nodes. And based on customer configuration, virtual nodes are within a single availability domain and fault domain within OCI. And the same availability domain and fault domain that you schedule your virtual node onto is where your applications run. So Kubernetes is aware of this topology the same as a real node. This allows you to seamlessly burst across the two types of nodes if you have that type of use case. And since they act like real nodes, except with greatly increased capacity, which is another selling point, they basically have infinite capacity since they're a serverless product. You'll be able to have those heterogeneous clusters. a virtual node has two main components to it. The first is pod management. So virtual nodes, like real nodes, have to observe when pods are scheduled onto them. They have to manage the lifecycle of pods, like restarting them if they go unhealthy. And they have to track the status of those pods. Like if a pod restarts, you want to know that a pod restarted later on to see if there's a problem like an kill happening. But the main difference between a virtual node and a managed node is how it manages the pod lifecycle. On a managed node, the kubelet is responsible for managing all the lifecycle state. It's the brains of the node, effectively. But in a virtual node, it delegates all that responsibility to virtual kubelet to perform that on behalf of container instances and the customer. And as I mentioned earlier, key distinction and different solution with virtual nodes is it supports up to 1,000 pods today, with the expectation we'll be doing more in the future, per virtual node. Whereas other competitors have a one-to-one relationship of pod to node, which greatly can limit your scalability of your cluster and your workloads. And the second area of responsibility that a virtual node has is the HTTPS API that the kubelet offers to provide various functionality, like execing into the pod, which is equivalent to SSHing into a normal host, or fetching logs from an application or pod, and a variety of other use cases. And the one key difference to think about is pod management is a leader-elected functionality. Only one virtual node replica that's highly available can perform that at a time. And so we designed that in a way where one is available as active and one is available as a hot standby. However, with the API that the kubelet has to offer, those are active-active. So they're both serving requests, they're both highly available for that use case. So we've been able to design the system in a way that is highly available for each specific use case to the best that we can offer. Another interesting aspect of virtual nodes is they actually only require one IP address, which is uncommon compared to some competitors where a lot of the times these managed resources, even the cluster, require 3 to 4 IP addresses each. So we've decreased the amount of space we have to consume from your IP addresses, which can be very slim to be able to pick from. And we accomplish this via some internal services that we have to provide our services that provide this advanced functionality. And another design trade-off that came out with this, which I kind of alluded to, is whether or not the API server and the virtual node have to communicate via back channel or directly through the customer's network. When we thought about this, we wanted to ensure that in every scenario possible, virtual nodes act like real nodes. And so they are in the same topology zone as you specify. They're not distributed across. And in this specific case of networking, we put them in the same network as the customer. And what this means is the customer controls the network ACLs for these virtual nodes. They can enable flow logs to monitor the traffic that are from the virtual node, where it's originating from and where it's going to, and also what's coming into it. And customers are able to have fully private clusters without backdoor channels in the cloud to offer the magical solution that they see. And this also ensures that during a failure scenario or a problem with your virtual cloud network, this should behave the same as your managed nodes to provide a seamless failure scenario that Kubernetes expects and that customers expects and can be able to recover from.
Got it. Cool. Well, that's a lot to unpack. So let me try to unpack this for the audience here. So essentially, virtual node, it's infinitely scalable, as in, you know, there's no real capacity limit per se, and it'll actually allocate container instances as pods as and when it needs in the back. In traditional managed nodes, you have kubelet that's actually implemented on the nodes, but in this case, that functionality is not on the container instances, they're actually on the virtual nodes, if you will, which is then implemented inside OCI infrastructure, if you will, in a managed fashion, in a HA fashion, so that, you know, there's no single point of failure. And then in order for, allow for communication to the virtual node and from the virtual node back to customer's virtual network, we essentially have network connectivity where even in spite of the HA, we actually have, network connectivity wherein, IP addresses or IP packets coming from different instances in the network inside OCI will appear as if it's actually the same IP addresses, so that from a customer standpoint, the virtual node looks exactly like a single node, even though behind the scenes we actually have multiple, physical VMs or whatever we actually use to implement them. Is that correct?
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah. In top of that, I think one of the things that I heard that I thought was interesting is we have HA for the virtual nodes, but at the same time, for the container instances, we kind of preserve the same topology as we do for managed nodes so that Kubernetes can essentially, you know, do the same failure logic that it does with managed nodes. Is that correct?
Yeah, exactly. So if a single availability domain were to go down, for example, Kubernetes has built-in awareness of these topology zones. And so Kubernetes would be able to look at all the virtual nodes that failed and then reschedule only the workloads in that availability domain to go to a subsequent availability domain. So that way there's capacity available and those ones are up and recover the application.
Got it. Cool. Well, so that's awesome. That's a lot of good details about, you know, how we did virtual nodes. As a customer, you know, should I just like move everything to virtual node now? Or, you know, when should I use virtual node and when should I use the regular VMs and BMs?
That's a great question. So we expect over time that the majority of customers will be shifting towards virtual nodes over traditional managed nodes. For a variety of reasons today, customers will still choose traditional nodes. And that could be because virtual nodes don't offer the feature set yet that they need, or they generally need the bare metal shape for a specific specialized workload. And since container instances are virtual machines, they don't plan to today support bare metal workload use cases. So in that scenario, we do expect customers to be using a heterogeneous cluster that is comprised of managed nodes for their specialized use cases and virtual nodes for the non. But in general, we expect that the majority of use cases, say the 99th percentile, will be shifting to virtual nodes over time as the feature set increases to cover what they expect from a managed node today. And there's one key thing to realize with virtual nodes versus managed nodes. Managed nodes ultimately have a goal to reduce the burden that container host infrastructure has on customers, the day two operational problem, and they can never really fully eliminate it. We can continue to build products that help make it simpler with patching automation or node auto repair and other advanced features of management functionality. Whereas virtual nodes, since they're fully serverless, we take on that burden for you. So there's no more enabling specific features, there's no more still having to SSH into hosts. We, OCI, take on the responsibility of the underlying infrastructure and manage it for you, completely eliminating the concern and letting you focus on your applications instead of the infrastructure. Another big difference in simplicity about why people would choose is around scaling. And as I mentioned a couple of times now, a virtual node has roughly 10x the capacity of a real node today. We have plans to increase that over time. And that allows customers to think less about how they scale their infrastructure and more about how they scale their application. And also one thing is pods today can support as small as 1 core and 1 gigabyte of RAM on container instances. And they can currently scale to 64 cores and 1 terabyte of memory. So every pod can right size itself with the ability over time for that to increase as well and ideally decrease as well to have smaller workloads like sub-core and burstable. And the last feature that customers really like about this is that the stronger isolation. So pods traditionally run on a VM or a bare metal, but they're ultimately relying on containers for isolation, which as anyone will say, containers are not a strong isolation story. You can't run untrusted workloads on them and expect to have safe security between them. But since container instances run in virtual machines, you do have strong isolation guarantees that you get from virtual machines, and you're able to more easily run untrusted and multi-tenant use cases within a cluster. So that's also a huge benefit that customers have seen from this.
Well, so to summarize, essentially virtual nodes that we recently launched allows customers to leverage container instances that we launched like a few months back in the context of OKE or OCI Kubernetes service. And you know the virtual node essentially allows for pretty much infinite scale with respect to node capacity, and it essentially allocates capacity on the fly in the form of container instances, which themselves bring in a massive advantages, including isolation, elastic capacity allocation, and management. And on top of that, the virtual nodes themselves are fully managed, and customers don't have to do anything. Specifically, the Kubelet that runs as part of the virtual nodes, you know, customers don't have to do anything about. You know, it's all, you know, all managed by OCI. And then, you know, obviously there are some use cases why customers would need, you know, the regular managed nodes, but to a large extent, we expect customers to, you know, gravitate towards virtual nodes. And I think that journey is going to, you know, happen more and more as we launch more features in the context of virtual nodes. Well, thank you for joining, and thank you for joining everyone.